Good evening, congregation. If you will find a place to sit, but remain standing as we read just two verses tonight, but powerful verses they are, Isaiah chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. You can follow along on the screen, or please open your Bibles to this, which is one of those glorious prophetic messages from Isaiah concerning our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. And Isaiah writes in verse 6, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with judgment and justice. From that time forward, even forever, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." Father, thank you so much that you gave the world a very distinct, perfect in his prophetic word, forewarning and great hope that the Savior was coming. And now we know who he is, who has fulfilled all prophecy concerning his first coming and will soon complete all the other prophecies concerning his second coming. We stand in honor of the Lord God Almighty, the Word of God that became flesh and dwelt among men. And tonight we behold his glory. May the ears of those who love the Lord be led by the Spirit to what the Spirit has to speak to them. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Please be seated. We are looking at, in just these two verses, actually five things that are told us concerning the Lord. We are told, first of all, that he will be human yet fully God, when we are told that unto us a child is born, but unto us a son is given. The child in full human form, the Son of God in full deity. Next, we are told four things through four titles that include eight words. Now, this is not problematic because, in fact, many of the names of God in the Hebrew are, in fact, translated into two English words. In fact, Isaiah is two Hebrew words that says that he is salvation. So tonight we are looking at the first of these doubles, and we will be studying these two verses tonight and three times after this. So tonight we're looking at Wonderful Counselor. On Sunday we will be studying Mighty God. And then next Wednesday night, Everlasting Father. And then finally, a week from this Sunday, the Prince of Peace. Now, I think this is important for us, particularly in this time in our nation and our world's history, where really Christ is being pulled out of Christmas. We need to make sure that the sense of this season is to celebrate the incarnation, the coming of Jesus in the flesh, dwelling among men. Now, we're pretty sure. I mean, there really are very, very few people that believe Jesus was born on December 25th. I don't think anybody's bothered by that this morning. We do know that Jesus was born. And just as importantly, he died and rose again on the third day. Now, these are the essences. This is the sense of the gospel. And so tonight, as we begin in verse 6, we're going to be talking about why it is that a child, that God himself, the Almighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace, our amazing, wonderful Counselor, would, as Pastor Connor mentioned in his prayer, as we began this evening, step from the realm of glory and walk among men and be discarded as refuse among those that he came to speak personally to. Tonight we're focusing mostly on that doublet, Wonderful Counselor, Wonderful Counselor. Now, Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, as I said, presents to us this glorious God who has this nature of humanity and, of course, the greatness, the fullness of the deity. Paul, in his letter to the church of Colossae, in fact said, "For it pleased the Father that in Jesus all the fullness of the deity should dwell." Jesus was not missing a portion of it. He was not missing any part of being fully God and yet, in his incarnation, fully man. And I appreciated what Pastor Stretchberry said last Sunday, that Jesus didn't come to show us what God looked like. He came to show us what man would be like in the presence of the Lord. I love that. Jesus did not come to show you what God looked like. In fact, many would suggest, and Isaiah himself suggests in Isaiah 53, that he was really nothing remarkable, rather, in fact, not pretty to look at all. He had no comeliness that any man would desire him, which means that he had no handsome quality, no beauty. You wouldn't necessarily look at him and go, "Whoa, wow, honey, don't look." You know, it's that kind of thing. In fact, you would probably look upon him and think, "Oh, you poor soul. You poor soul." I mean, if maybe a comb over or something like that would really help. But you wouldn't look at him and think, "Man, if I could ever look like that, it'd be really cool." Now, I know that in a sense of really devotion and adoration of God, many artists as have attempted to present Christ as really a rather beautiful man. And in recent Christian movies, a little boy that says that he went to heaven attested that Jesus was a beautiful, blonde, blue-haired, surfer-kind guy that was, of course, very handsome. In fact, that's not how John presents him in the book of Revelation. But in Jesus, fully man, fully God. Isaiah says so much about Jesus in his prophecies. Isaiah says so much to encourage us with respect to not only who he is, but who we are and will be. In Isaiah chapter 11, verses 1 through 5, Isaiah prophesies concerning Jesus, "There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots." Now, I just want to say to you, this is almost 600 years before Jesus would come in his incarnation. And he mentions not only David's father, but of course David and the royal lineage of David, that of course the Messiah must have a heritage through, and Jesus did. "The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist." Well, that is amazing. That in itself would be worth a series for Christmas lectures. But of course also Isaiah chapter 9 verses 6 and 7 is one of those Christmas scriptures that is often repeated at Christmas times because, of course, it speaks directly to the blessing of being given this child who is fully God and fully man. Eight words 8 words that encompass 4 great titles. Tonight, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor. I'll note for you that at the close of verse 7, Isaiah says that it is by the zeal of the Lord that he will perform this amazing, this miraculous, this excellent, this glorious, this colossal, this stupendous capacity to counsel each one of us where we are in the midst of what is happening in our lives and provide for us specific counsel as to how we would escape the temptation to build his kingdom, perhaps out of the rubble of what the world leaves in your life. We know from just about any college dictionary, I have one here, that says the word wonderful means extremely good, pleasant, remarkable. But remember, we're talking about the Lord's capacity to counsel you. In other words, your response to God's counseling should always be, boy, that was excellent. That was really good. In fact, that was extremely good. That was remarkable. Now, I don't know what couples say when they come out of counseling from my office. I don't know for sure that that's what they say. But every time the Lord speaks into my life, I know this. Wow, that was remarkable. That was remarkable. He knows exactly what to say at the right time to just give me hope. Peter describes it as a living hope in 1 Peter chapter 1. Wonderful counselor. In fact, the Hebrew word pele is used elsewhere in the Bible to describe something miraculous. Miraculous counsel. The term miraculous typically also brings with it the idea of something that happens rather immediately. In other words, it wasn't there previously, and now it is. The answer to this problem wasn't so discernible right then, but now, boy, I get it completely. I really get it. Wonderful, miraculous counsel. This is who our God is. And he loves to counsel his children. Now, as a parent, I love to counsel my children as well. And I remember with great affection the times when my son would call me from England, from Bristol, and he would say, Dad, this is what's going on. What should I do? And I wouldn't tell him what to do, but I would say, you know, here are some options, and pray in this direction. Because I am not the wonderful counselor. I'm not the miraculous counselor. I'm not the excellent counselor, but I know he who is. And I know that in ministry, if not perhaps we could say in every arena of life, we need God to speak into our lives. We just really do. Isn't it amazing that tonight you have a counselor that for over 2,600 years men and women have described as wonderful, as wonderful. I love that. Isaiah chapter 28, verse 29 says, this also comes from the Lord of hosts, who is wonderful in counsel and excellent in guidance. You might say counsel and guidance is very similar. I would suspect that when I like to, in counseling, give guidance. Right? And I would like to say that that guidance would take the form of a prescription. Prescription. Much like a doctor would write on a little slip of paper, here's what I would like you to take. Take this 4 times a day for the next 6 days, with food or without food, but make sure you take it. And every time the time comes up, make sure you take it. Now, in fact, there was an entire book written on it. The title of the book was God's Psychiatry. God's psychiatry. And the premise of the book was this: to take the scriptures, particularly in the Psalms, and apply them as a prescription for those that were ailing in life. And in fact, in a number of different areas that would be problematic in any person's life, it prescribed certain psalms that you would sit down. Let's say you would take something at 6 a.m. in the morning. Well, you would stop and read that psalm at 6 a.m. Well, the next time you would be taking, the next pill at noon every 6 hours, you would sit down and you would read that scripture again, or you would read the other scriptures that were involved with that prescription. I like to do this as a counselor. I like to send people home with something for them to do that would be prescriptive or that would be guidance for their lives to get over the hump, get over the issue, and see it in hindsight as something that someone may have designed to do evilly, but God has made to come out wonderfully. Genesis chapter 50, verse 20, which, by the way, is a great prescription for many things in life as well. Here Isaiah says, "Who is wonderful in counsel, excellent in guidance." Now, with couples or someone that I'm counseling, and I know that I'm going to be seeing them again, I always like to give homework. And typically, when they're coming back for their second appointment, if they haven't done their homework, I'm not going to see them. Now, I don't know a lot of doctors outside of the fact that they charge a lot of money, don't they? And they don't come if they don't care if you come and you haven't even tasted the pill. They're going to get their money anyways. But I want the homework to be done. I want the Word of God to find a home in the heart of those that need counsel, that are hoping for guidance, or else why would they be coming? We're all busy enough where we don't need to just come, you know, make up another program or something else to come to. So I like to give homework to those that will be coming a second time or third or fourth time. But if they come one time, they come 20 times, which is rare, I will always give a prescription. This is what I want you to read. I want you to read it 4 times a day. And I want you to come back telling me I read every one of the scriptures every day at the time that you told me to read them. And lo and behold, it turns out that this guy didn't do anything. But the Word of God had this amazing capacity to bring about counseling and guidance in arenas that only opened that heart to listen to the Holy Spirit. Something rather amazing happens when you get into the Word of God and you begin to repeat it. And by the way, I didn't mention this, but I also tell them, I want you not just to read it, I want you to say the verses. Speak the word so that you speak it, your ears hear it, it is finding a treasure in your heart. Now you might think, well, that's pretty remedial. That's kind of, you know, you're treating me like a third grader. But no, I'm not. I just know what works. That's the deal, you know. You're not going to go back to a doctor where he provides you nothing that's going to work. You're not going to come back to God if he's not going to provide anything that's not going to work. By the way, I love the fact that when we go to our counselor, can I put him in those terms? To our wonderful counselor, I know that my God is sympathetic to the trials, the temptations, the issues that I'm going through. Now, this is kind of hard to swallow sometimes, to think in terms of our God, Jesus, the living Word, who came and dwelt among men in the flesh, and as we're told in Hebrews chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, in fact, was tempted in every possible point of human temptation. Think about that. I guarantee you, no matter how old you are, have not been tempted in all points of human temptation. I can't imagine what the agenda for each day would be. Well, Jesus wakes up and he looks at this list of things. You're going to be tempted in these 5,000 things today, because in your 33 years, we've got about 8 million temptations to go through. Because at the end of your ministry in the flesh, you've got to have a resume that will be able to sympathize with every human need that will ever come to you. In desperation to say, oh Lord God, if you only knew. Here's what the writer of Hebrews says in verse 15. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Would you please note in verse 15, and boy, you know, I'm just going to tell you, this is a walnut that's tough to swallow for me. It is. What does he sympathize concerning our life experience? He sympathizes concerning the weakness that we all bear. Now, some of us bear physical weakness. Some of us bear emotional weakness. You might describe your life as financially weak at this point. You might describe it as relationally weak. There's a lot of different arenas that humans can really feel as though, boy, I just wish I was stronger in that. Boy, I wish I was stronger in that area. Because I don't like, perhaps, you know, falling to the default of crying when these things happen, or I'm always the doormat, or whatever it is. But isn't it wonderful, but also tough to realize that Jesus took the form of man in his weakness to be tempted in every possible temptation that human beings could be tempted in. Every single one, we are told here, was in all points tempted as we are. Every single point. Now, many years ago, I was suggesting to this woman who came to our church over on McCoy Lane. You don't know her, probably will never know her. It's no one in the church now, and you'll never meet her. She may live on another planet now, as far as I'm concerned. But I told her, please, 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 please do not continue to date this married man. Oh, he's promised me he's going to leave his wife. They're really in separation relationally, even though they still live together. And I said, please, I'm telling you, God is never going to bless this. And so she, as each of you have the capacity to do, exercised her ability to go anywhere she wants to church, and she went to a church that agreed with her, to a pastor that agreed with her. And she was nice enough to call me and say, well, I'm going to another church. And the pastor here said, well, Pastor Paul surely couldn't understand your need for counseling because he's never been divorced. As if that disqualified me from counseling people, because I've never experienced being divorced. Now, I don't see that as a skill set in the requirements of an elder in 1 Timothy chapter 3 or Titus chapter 1. Paul just forgot to mention that. Well, and by the way, if you could get divorced at some point in ministry, it would really help you to be a better counselor. So here's the thing, friends. I don't need to be sinning in every arena of life to be able to tell you, don't do that, because here's why. Here's what happened to me. I've done enough sin. I've given into enough temptations to tell you it's not a good road to take. But look at this. We have a high priest whose immediate response to you in the midst of your need, his immediate response is to sympathize with you. Because he knows the desperate weakness of our hearts, our countenance, our constitution, whatever it is. He knows that we're weak. And in every single possible point of temptation, he was tempted, yet without sin. Isn't that amazing? To be tempted is not a sin. That's also what it says here. To be tempted is not a sin. He was tempted in all things. And yet, of course, we know he was not sinful. Now, verse 16 tells us that this lovely, omnipotent God who stepped into a weak humanity and was tempted in all points of temptation that humans are tempted in was also one who sympathizes with us and invites us into his throne room to come running in boldly when we have a need of help. Isn't that great? God says, yeah, come on down. I know exactly what you're going through. And here's how I want to help you. I want you to know that God knows how to bail you out. He knows how to bail you out of every temptation. Psalm chapter 34, verses 19 through 20 says, many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. You don't have a single temptation, affliction, sin, any problem in life that Jesus is not capable of delivering you out of. And by the way, also to say, listen, I know exactly what's going on. I know exactly what's going on. Now, I want you to take a look with me. If you open your Bibles, this is something that I've gone through with you before, but I want to just mention these again. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Three very important things that God provides for you in the midst of temptation. Three very important things. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13. Many of you, if you have ever been in navigators studies, if you've ever been in the military, if you were ever involved with Campus Crusade for Christ, which I believe they call CREW now, this is one of the first scriptures that you were encouraged to memorize, because it is deeply satisfying in the midst of a great trial. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 13 tells us three things. First, it tells us, no temptation has overtaken you except such as is common to man. Then note, please, there is a semicolon there in the English version of the Bible. What is that saying? God, again, knows personally what you're going through and will not allow anything to happen to you that has never happened to any other person in the world. In other words, you can't come to God and say, boy, you know, you're God, I know, and you're tempted in all things, but I'm sure you were never tempted in this. Or you might talk to your pastor or friends, there's no way you would understand what's going on with me right now. Girl, it's horrible. No. This scripture is saying to you, you have not been tempted with something that has never tempted anyone else in the world. In fact, there's a list of temptations somewhere. I don't know where it is. Jesus fulfilled them all. But all these temptations are common to every human being. You may not have been tempted by them all, but there's no special situation that marks you as a person that was tempted beyond all human capacity. Jesus promises us this isn't something that no one else has ever dealt with. You're not that special case. Number two, he tells us, God is faithful. That's enough. But he says more, who will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you are able. Number one, it's not an uncommon trial. Number two, he will not allow this temptation to overwhelm you. He knows what you can stand, and he will not let any temptation trouble you beyond what you can stand at the point of your maturity in Christ. You might think, well, this is too much. No, how can God, a loving God, allow me to go through? You know what? That question is ridiculous. Because you are presupposing that God's too stupid to figure out that it was too much for you. No. You see what a wrong foundation that is to start with? God, you know everything. And somehow, in the way that you are working this in me, you know that my wonderful counselor can build me to the place where I can count it all joy, brethren, to encounter this various trial. Thank you, Jesus. I know that it's not too great because Jesus is totally in control of all things that come into my life. Lastly, thirdly, with the temptation will also make the way of escape that we may be able to bear it. So number one, no uncommon, special temptation no one's ever known about. Number two, he will not allow any temptation to be one that could overwhelm you. Number three, in that temptation, he will always provide an escape, a plan for you to come out better, not bitter. Better, not bitter. If your God's small, if your God's not wonderful, if your counselor is not an excellent, miraculous one, then you could come out bitter. Simply because, you know what? You didn't know what you were talking about. You had no idea the depth of this problem. No, our wonderful, our excellent, our miraculous counselor knows the depth of every issue in our lives. And he waits to deliver us out of them all. Remember that? Psalm 34, verse 19. The Lord delivers him out of them all. Isn't it wonderful that God loves to teach his children? And of course, counseling is a matter of teaching. Oftentimes, I will sit with couples and I'll say, okay, so let's look at this scripture. With married couples, I always start in Ephesians chapter 5. And I'll typically start in verse 18, and I'll talk about the filling of the Holy Spirit. We'll talk about the glorious wonder of being filled with the Spirit and singing in spiritual psalms, and how a family is to be covered by the spiritual songs of a house, of a spiritual leader, and bathing his children and his wife in the water of God's Word. We'll talk about verse 22, where a wife finds her greatest joy and freedom in submission to her husband. We'll talk about verse 25, where a man finds his greatest freedom and his deepest joy in sacrificing his life for his wife and family. And oftentimes when I go there, it's typically without fail that the husband or the wife, I know those verses. In fact, sometimes they've even given them back to me verbatim. But here's the point. See, a counselor doesn't want you just to have it here. What does he want? He wants you to have it here, doesn't he? This is what the Lord, our wonderful counselor, our excellent counselor, our miraculous counselor, wants you to take what's here and bury it here. Some have said that those 18 inches between here and here is the roughest highway in life. Because the highway between here and here is often filled with pretty rocky roads. To really know what the Word of God is, as Peter would suggest in his first epistle, to really know it means that you have to live through the honor, the privilege of suffering for Christ's sake. Somehow suffering, temptation, problem and trouble in our life drives us, or hopefully would drive us, oh Lord, I come to you in my time of need, and I come boldly, I come quickly, because I know you're a high priest that sympathizes. I know a high priest that cares for me and wants to speak into my life. This is how I know my God. But nominal Christians, some have referred to them as Sunday Christians, are people that fill their minds with Christian ideas. Chuck Swindoll once said, "The problem with Christianity is you can learn to do it." Do you get what he means? The problem with Christianity is you can learn to do it. But you see, Christianity is something that you must want to do. I don't want to learn to be a husband. I want to be a husband. I don't want to learn necessarily to be a father. I want to be a father. I want to be a lover. Lord, teach me. Lord, teach me. Isaiah chapter 2, once again, Isaiah, so good. Verse 3 of chapter 2, many people shall come and say, come, let us go into the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways. Woe to those that end up in churches where they don't learn anything because the word of God is absent from their halls. Thank you, Lord, that the word of God always teaches us his ways. Psalm 32 verse 8 says, I will instruct you and teach you in the way that you should go. I will guide you with my eye. I like that. Psalm 86 verses 10 through 12, for you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name, and I will praise you, O Lord, my God, with all my heart. Wonderful chorus we used to sing many years ago. I will glorify your name forevermore. Teach me your ways, O Lord. Take it from here and put it here. And I would venture to say that every one of you, because you come on Wednesday nights, are people that clearly understand, I want the word for not just to come in here and bounce around this tin can for a couple days. I want it to come down and rest in here. I want it to live in my life. Question is, are you teachable? Can the wonderful counselor speak into your life through his word and through his spirit? See, the word and the spirit. Can he do that into your life and know that he will find rich soil in your heart that will bear great fruit and multiply wonderfully? If we sow to the spirit, from the Spirit we will reap everlasting life. You can't call him wonderful counselor if you're unwilling to follow his commandments, his prescriptions. You can't depend on the Lord's counsel if you don't believe his wisdom is marvelous above all of the counsel. I'm surprised at Christians that will run to even ungodly, unchristian friends and ask them, what should I do with this husband of mine? And you know what they're going to say. Kick him out. Put him in the doghouse. Make sure he sleeps on the couch. What would God say? Might God suggest, humble thyself in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Amazing. He will lift you up because you have humbled yourself before the Lord. God's counsel often is the opposite of the world's. I'm sorry, Dr. Phil. Phil comes up with some good things once in a while when he mentions the Lord in people's lives. But friends, worldly wisdom will never satisfy this desperate hunger in our hearts to know what our wonderful counselor might say. Lastly, I'm just going to say this. Do you keep regular appointments with your wonderful counselor? I can, and I do. I meet with my wonderful counselor every single day. I was asked once, do you have a therapist? I said, yeah. Oh, man, he's good. Could I get an appointment with him? I said, absolutely. Oh, I know you could. You ever get readings? Yeah, I get readings every day. Ever have your fortune? Oh, Lord, does he give me fortune? Yeah, you see, the reason these palm readers, these prognosticators, these people that make a living out of telling you what you already know, is because, in fact, that's what we want. But I want my counselor to lead me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. You see, I want counsel that is miraculous. I would not come to God if I didn't believe that he could change me. You have regular appointments with this wonderful counselor. I pray that you do. If you have a problem tonight, all you need do is run boldly to your wonderful counselor. His doors are open right now. He is open for business tonight. I know that he is. And by the way, he will be tomorrow. The other night, I met with him at 2 in the morning. And he does house calls. And fill out a prescription right where you're right while you're waiting for him. Who is like that? I don't know. I do know this, and this is where we're going to close. In Revelation chapter 3, odd place to end this, but it's so good. Revelation chapter 3. In fact, to the church of Philadelphia, God promises, and I believe we're that church, promises that no one can prevent us from receiving all that he has for you. No one can but you. No one can prevent you from receiving everything that God has for you except you. Here's what he says to the church of Philadelphia, to the church in Philadelphia, right? These things says he who is holy, who is true. He who has the key of David, he who opens and no one shuts, and shuts and no one opens. I love that. I know your work. See, I have set before you an open door, and no one can shut it. Don't you love it when God opens the door? Because you know if he's opened it, no one's going to shut it. Nuh-uh. For you have a little strength. You have kept my word, and you've not denied my name. Indeed, I will make those of the synagogue of Satan who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Indeed, I will make them come and worship before your feet and to know that I have loved you. Isn't that amazing? The world will one day know because they will come to your feet that the Lord God, the wonderful counselor, the purveyor of all the stars of heaven, has loved you. You personally. Because you have kept my word, my command to persevere, I will also keep you from the hour of trial which shall come upon the whole world to test those who dwell on the earth. Behold, I am coming quickly. Thank you, Jesus. Hold fast what you have that no one may take your crown. Verse 12, he who overcomes, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God. He shall go out no more. I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. I may go to the grave without a tattoo, but I know one day I will have the very name of Jesus himself written upon me. And the name of the great new city in which the Lord God of all heaven and earth shall dwell. And what will mark me above all these things? Friends, the blood of Jesus. Blood of Jesus. What do you have tonight? You have the blood of Jesus if you're a Christian. You have access to the greatest counselor in all this universe. You have access right now. And no matter what time of day or night, you need to speak to him. He's ready to speak to you. Take what you know here and put it here. Father, I thank you for the word that is complete, satisfying, miraculous. Lord, I know you speak to us, not just through your word, but also through your spirit. And Father, in the wee hours of the night, when we shed the tears of our desperation, in whatever situation has befallen us, oh Father, I know this. You know the moment that our hearts reach to your throne room. You know the moment that we come running boldly into the tabernacle of the fiery God of all heaven and earth. And you say, come. And you say, I love you. And you say, listen, here's what I prescribe for you. Thank you, Father, that each of us through the blood of Jesus have that access tonight. Each of us this very night can seek your face and know what you have to say for us. And I thank you for that in Jesus' name, my wonderful counselor. Amen. Amen.